sense of like something, you know, we're not like, we've not always been part of, you know, the British Empire, like the colonialism. We're, you know, I think finding pride has to come from other, obviously other sources, unless you genuinely are proud of that, in which case, but that, this side of being English, like the comedy, the kind of the music, the culture, the cultural output of England is really amazing. I mean, I look back at, you know, a lot of my biggest influences have also been English bands. It's funny, I mean, I actually really, wasn't really like a fan of Oasis at the time, but I went to, I'm a big fan. Lots of bands kind of eluded me until I was a bit older, because I mostly listened to piano-based music.
Mm.
And
like Mozart?
Yeah, whether it was classical or I listened to a lot of like soul, classical, Japanese kind of ambient type.
Like kabuki or something? There.
Like, I don't know what that is, but
I don't either.
So, yeah, but no, I mean, it could be a genre, though, something I don't know about, but, Ryo Ichi Sakamoto is a good example. You should listen to him, I think you'd like him a lot.
Sakamoto?
Very calming.
Oh, really?
Beautiful,
oh,
yeah.
I can use that.
Ryo Ichi Sakamoto.
Can you bring him up? Let's see an image of him. I want to see a JPEG of this fella. Ryuki?
Ryuchi.
Ryuchi.
Oh,
I love Japanese people, man. Went to Japan one time and we took a bunch of ice creams with us to the park and we gave them to kids and took pictures of them eating.
Oh, there he is. I mean, beautiful, man.
Oh, God, he is. I look like my mother a little. In the face, not in the hair.
Mm.
Actually, if his hair was a lot longer.
Yeah, right.
He looks like a composer, doesn't he?
I mean, just a legend.
I'd love to be Japanese. I think it feels like everything's just so damn organized inside of you, you know? I feel like you swallow water and immediately ready to be
It's immediately, yeah, efficiently processed.
Oh, there's no
doubt. Building around.
You know? Right.
Oh, more to the kidneys. Get out of here. Mm-hmm. BS.
Straight through.
It's just wrecked. It just.
Train.
Yes, that's it. Yes, it seems just like here
right.
We go.
I mean,
you fit into a shirt size. I feel like if you're Japanese, you fit in. There is no like you're in the middle. I can't. This looks bad on me. You know, I feel like you are.
There's a definite. There's a definable. Like when you go to Tokyo, for example, there's a definable style identity.
Yeah,
and I've found that some of the most stylish people I've ever met. Have been Japanese,
mm-hmm.
And some of the most stylish kind of like ideas in clothing have been come from. I mean, this is actually. I mean, I'm not saying this. I'm not saying I'm sorry. I think this is like.
It's very Japanese.
One of the it is, and it's by Yoji Yamamoto.
Mm.
But I wear a lot of Japanese clothes because I just think they. Yamamoto and Isamiyaki are like my favorite designers.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know, going back to when I was a kid, yeah, lots of Japanese music. And I think I was also fascinated by like Western and Japanese crossovers. Just like the intersection between those sounds. And one thing you find is that Every culture has its kind of own chord, kind of, or tonality, what's the word, sort of like world of notes that sound good together in that, you know, style. So, for example, in French music, right, so like French early classical, whatever, it's like there's a world of tone that kind of sounds French, if you know what you're listening for.
Mm.
to the when you go to the Eurostar. It's funny. There's a sound that plays. It's like whatever. It's like a thing, and it's the most French notes.
Oh, interesting.
That have ever been written. Yeah.
That's funny. If you know a lot about music, you're probably able to hear a lot of different like little just things in the world and know like press them back.
Yeah.
It's almost like Latin. Like if you know sounds, it's almost like
you
learn Latin. That's interesting.
Everything's rooted in something. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, when you go to Japan, there's a lot of sounds in like train stations and shit that they have, and you just go, "Wow, this is nothing like anything that I'm used to." It's kind of amazing.
Do you notice any difference between the audiences like in different places, like in some of the behavior of them and stuff? Like
Japan's
that?
A really interesting place to play because a lot of the audiences they're like super respectful. At least for the shows that we've put on, they'll be completely silent during the music and then erupt in like the loudest possible applause. And then as soon as they sense that you're ready to start the next song, complete silence. It feels.
Or does it feel like right?
It's different. It's like. It feels right there. But it's so. I can understand the logic behind it. And there's such respect that comes with that. It's like they really, really respect the art and what you're doing. And also, we were there, you know, we're kind of. We don't go there very often. So. And you're not. You know, if you go too often, start to see. Almost, but they respond especially like that, I think, to people who are from out of town and come in and just kind of more of a rarity. It's like they just really want to be present for the.
They want to miss it.
Yeah.
They want to be in the moment.
Yeah.
Maybe they value the moment a bit. Maybe there's more of a value for the moment. They have so much history.
Well, I wonder if it's also a politeness. So many moments that it's kind of expansive.
And we've kind of had that in America. Like, we've got unlimited moments, you know?
Exactly.
But now I think things are starting to change a little bit. It's like, man, we need to value this moment. I think
the economy of moments, basically. It's like we are now in a moment where we don't have that many like live interactive experiences. So I would think that people are starting to go, when they go to comedy shows or whatever, they're probably paying a little bit more. You know, they're like, feel a bit more grateful to be there, feel a bit more grateful to like have access to someone in real life after just spending a pandemic, not being able to see anyone, not being able to go out, apart from in Tennessee, obviously. But like, back to that, someone is stood in front of you and they've spent their whole life perfecting this art form, and then you go there and then you just talk all over it. And the idea of doing that after the pandemic seemed more insane than. Seem ungrateful.
Like, especially when you guys, the people are more likely to take part in stuff during your shows and have fun.
Yeah.
You know, comedy, you're really people have to sit and listen for the most part.
Yeah, although a lot of people. I actually hate it.
Like, tell me what happens. What do you mean they
should? Well, I'll be playing something and I'm in the middle of a song and someone just goes, like, you know, they'll say something crowd like, you know, like, yeah. Well, I love you. And I'm like, in my brain, I'm like, I love you too, but I don't, can't say anything because I'm
doing your work,
doing my thing. And someone else just shuts and goes, shh. And you're like, what it says, the thing is, I always feel like responsible for what they've just done. Because I feel like maybe something I put across, maybe it's just an insecurity, but I feel like something I put across has made them feel like I wouldn't like it.
Oh, that's interesting.
You know, I wouldn't like it if someone like expresses how excited they are or whatever.
I feel like, I want you to think that they're a warden for me.
I feel like some kind of like, yeah, like real, like stick up my ass fucking.
Dude, I used to feel that way about girls I would date and stuff. I didn't want any girl to be like a reflection of me. So like, if they made a mistake or, like, I used to date this one girl who had no, like, beautiful, really sweet girl. She had no sense of, like, spatial awareness.
Right.
She would just be, like, you know, talking to you, and, like, she'd bump into 65 people somehow, like, just while she was talking.
She's a dodger.
She's what?
A dodger. We call them dodgems.
Yeah.
It's one of those, you know, like, the cars that bump into each other.
Yeah.
The fairground.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was just a, like, oh, my God, don't you know somebody's right behind you? She would always turn and knock over a damn glass or a top hat off of somebody, you know?
Yeah.
And it would just, like, it drove me.
What would you do?
It just meant, because I didn't want her to be a reflection of who I, it would be like.
Yeah.
I didn't want anybody thinking, like, oh, man. It's such a narcissistic thing, really.
He endorses, he's, like,
right,
cool with this.
Right.
Which makes him also as kind of unwieldy and fucking, you know.
Uncool or whatever.
Yeah, not cool. In some way, ultimately, it comes back to I'm not accepted. Or
whatever. Right.
But, you know, I did exactly the same thing, but with like social interactions and like if somebody said the wrong thing, I'd prickle up and like feel really tense and like it'll come out with a little comment towards them at some point, you know, later or even during the conversation, and I just couldn't hide it. I was so uncomfortable with somebody else fucking up. Because ultimately, like, the school I went to was just like, people were so hard on each other if someone fucked up. Right, so you just develop this thing of like, no one must say anything wrong. No one can